Last session of the day. It will be a very interesting one, as I already mentioned, and one that will have information that many of you probably are not confronted with on a daily basis. But the mic on? But Rafe, you said you cannot hear? Now it's better. Okay, let me start from the beginning. So this last session is actually one that deals with what can we do on a global basis in terms of regulating greenhouse gases and thereby temperatures. A lot of this material, you know, some of you are familiar with it on regular basis, but some of you might not have heard a lot about it. So we will have an overview talk that will be followed by another talk on the topic of CDR, carbon dioxide reduction. Then we will have two talks that are on other methods of temperature regulation. And the last two by Phil and by Simone will be via Skype, and we know how that works. Those of us who have been here all day, the other two talks, of course, will be here from the podium. The session will be chaired by Janos Pastor, who is currently a senior fellow and director of the Carnegie Climate Geoengineering Governance Project at the Carnegie Center for Ethics in International Affairs. So Janos will introduce his work and then move over to introducing the speakers in the order of Julio, Alyssa, Phil and Simone.
Indeed, as was already mentioned, I was asked to say just a few words about what we're trying to do at the Carnegie Center, and I will do that. And then I would like to just say a few words about the session and how we'll do it. So, very briefly, less than 3 months ago, I had no idea about what is geoengineering and that one day I would actually work on that. Well, I had some idea, but not much. I've worked most of my life on climate change, but more on the other side of mitigation, adaptation, and intergovernmental processes, and most recently working as Assistant Secretary General for Climate Change in the United Nations. But I stopped that earlier this year, and at the right moment, in the right place, somebody said, would you be interested in taking on a multi-year project to work on governance for climate geoengineering? And I said, yes, I would. And here I am. So what are we trying to do? This project is hosted by the Carnegie Council, and we are not promoting geoengineering, neither are we against geoengineering, but what we are clearly promoting is governance frameworks, because we believe that essentially, apart from a few small exceptions, there are no frameworks in place for geoengineering, neither for more substantial research for geoengineering, and in particular, not for eventual potential deployment of geoengineering techniques. So, why are we doing this? We're all very happy, of course, with the Paris Conference. It was a great success, major step forward, but life, the world is not perfect. And there are many who believe that it's a certainly plausible scenario that in a few years, countries will find that we're actually heading to 2.5, 3 degrees, 3.5, maybe even more degrees centigrade, because the development pressure is much higher in India than people thought, because the costs are maybe higher than people thought, or maybe the money that was supposed to be available for the INDCs is not in fact available. So it's a plausible future that countries in a few years might say, oh my God, what are we going to do? And then they will very quickly turn to this method that may provide some solutions or give some time for action, but without having thought it through. And that's what we would like to avoid. We would like to make sure that we will have thought it through before countries really address this issue. There is a worse scenario, and this is the good scenario, that people will find that we're on a track for 3-4 degrees, and therefore countries will turn to it. But a more challenging scenario would be a rogue state or a crazy billionaire deciding that they will save the world and do that. Or let's say a crazy billionaire who quietly does some geoengineering for, let's say, 2 years without telling anybody, and then says, okay, if you don't raise the interest rates, I'll stop. So, you know, those are a little bit out of the box, but nevertheless, one has to think about them. So anyway, this is what we're trying to do, and we will do that through a number of streams of work. But the idea is simply to shift the debate from academia, where it is today, and shift it into the policy, the intergovernmental policy arena. And because so far most of the action has been in the academia. And we will do that by working with intergovernmental organizations. We will do that by perhaps setting up some high-level panel or commission that will make some recommendations. We will work with government officials quietly initially and then eventually in some open way and so on. But we'll also work with key civil society organizations and, yes, of course, with the private sector as well, because they also have something to do. So I will stop there, but if there are, of course, questions on that, I would be very happy to engage in a discussion during the session or very briefly afterwards. I'm afraid I'll have to leave, but anyway. Now, let's come to the session, because we do have 2 hours for this, and in the first hour, we'll hear a number of statements. We will first hear from Julio, about 20 minutes, and then 10 minutes each from Alyssa, who is sitting here, and then we have Phil and Simon, who are hopefully already connected on Skype, and I see some technology behind me, so let's hope that works. So if they stick to their 20 versus 10 minutes time slots, then that means we'll have an hour for discussion, and I hope we can do that. And maybe it's good to recall what we're trying to achieve at this session. The Arctic is a pretty nice place, and it's a pretty important place. And clearly, in fact, many of the discussions when people talk about some regional approaches to geoengineering, the first that comes into mind is the Arctic. Let's do something in the Arctic. And I myself had the opportunity to be up there twice with the UN Secretary General, once almost 8 years ago now, and last year. And literally, physically, with our own eyes, we could see the difference. By the time we were there last year, they were measuring 2 degrees. And you could see the impact. You didn't have to have measured things over a long period of time to see the impact. So clearly, the Arctic is an area where we need action. Now, what do we want to know through this session? There are really 3 things that I think it's good to make those points up front, and I hope that the speakers will address those. The first one is, what is really the basic science that we need? Any further research that we need to understand better what's going on and what sort of actions can we take? So that's one. The second is that what is the time scale of the potential actions that we can do? Because if we do something now that will have an impact in 30 years, that's different than something that can have an impact in 6 months. So time scales of interventions. And thirdly, what are the costs, risks, and benefits of these interventions, both within the Arctic region itself and maybe elsewhere? Those are the 3 key things. So if you can focus on that, I think that would be very helpful. And also, when we start the discussion, if you could sort of gather your questions and your comments around those. So with that, I think we should start. And I would like to ask Julio, please.
I'm Julio Friedman. I promise you I'm the only Julio Friedman you will ever meet. Just a word of background. Until recently, I was formally part of the problem. My last job was, I was often introduced as Obama's coal guy, so loved by all. I was the principal deputy assistant secretary for the Office of Fossil Energy, and it was my job, among other things, to manage a $600 million a year research program focused in no small part on carbon capture and storage. Before that, I was actually both a research manager and practitioner for carbon capture, utilization, and storage. So said differently, I know things about stuff. The idea here is to give you guys a little bit of sense of what's going on. Let me start with a couple of quick things that are worth noting. First, this is not geoengineering, this is engineering. This is not something that a Bond villain will do. This is something that people have been doing for a long time, and as a consequence, we understand quite well. It's a question of finance and policy now more than a question of technology, and I hope you get that sense. Second of all, the basic science for storage is more or less settled. There's basic science for other stuff where there's some good work to be done, and we'll hopefully have a chance to talk about that in a bit. So normally when I give this talk, I spend some time explaining just how dire the circumstance is. You already know that, so let's skip on to where we're at. A two-degree world is basically the green. A one-and-a-half-degree world is the blue. If you're paying attention, you notice that they both require negative emissions technologies pretty soon. And that means that we actually need those technologies deployed in the market well before that, because otherwise you can't get, you know, 10 gigatons of negative emissions out there. Just for your benefit, I know you all know what a gigaton is, kind of, at least, but most people don't go to the store and buy a gigaton of carrots. So a gigaton is twice the weight of all the human beings on Earth. So 10 billion tons of CO2 is 20 times the mass of humanity. It's a good number to kick around. Something that is not said nearly enough is if you don't have carbon capture and storage, we're just not going to hit that target. For those of you who are part of the Working Group 3 effort, you might know this better than others, but essentially the chance of success if you don't have carbon capture and storage is less than 50%. They were not able to get the models to converge half the time if you didn't have CCS. Similarly, if you don't have CCS and the models did converge, it typically costs about 140% more. And the reason why is because CCS is for the hard to scrub parts of the economy. There's parts of the world that have terrible renewable resources. There's things like steel mills and cement plants that you can't decarbonize easily any other way. And this is actually in part what CCS is for. If all we were worried about was the power sector, you'd still be doing some CCS, but it wouldn't be that linchpin technology. Here, if you don't have CCS, you're cooked, literally. So it's worth knowing what this is and why it matters. One last word. It turns out that you need this regardless of the demand scenarios. For this is just for the US, but it works for the world too. High demand, low demand world, you still do CCS. CCS is the hatched parts, and you don't just do it for coal. A lot of people think this is a coal technology. It's not. It's an emissions reduction technology. So you will do it on coal, you will do it on gas, you will do it on heavy industry, and ultimately you'll end up doing it on biofuels as well. And you just need it. It's one of those things you got to do. The good news is the people in Paris recognize this. Paris was a major outcome. Y'all know the part on the right. The left, the part on the right is, you might not know, 10 countries formally listed CCS as part of their NDCs, saying that that was a piece of their emission strategy. A number of countries, like the United States and China, tacitly announced that. They said this is a compliance mechanism, or this is part of our plan. Without requiring it to be part of their nationally determined contribution, they still noted that it was something they were likely to do. And as we said before, negative emissions is kind of its own thing. I'll sort of end with that and then turn that over to people like Alyssa who are more versed in such topics. Something that I'm often asked, to my great sadness, I guess, as people say, well, is this like cold fusion, or is this like a pixie dust? Like, is it something that might exist someday, or is it something that's impossible? And I go, plant. We've got a big plant operating in Canada. This is a retrofit of an existing coal-fired power plant. CO2 was going into the air. Now it's undergoing going underground at the rate of a million plus tons a year. Okay? This is not science fiction. This is not actually anything other than dyed-in-the-wool engineering. The first carbon capture technology was fielded in 1938. The first carbon storage technology was fielded in 1972. We actually know how to do this really, really well. And we've had two decades of solid science looking at storage, and we know that it works well. It is effective, easy to operate, easy to manage. And this plant is sort of, you know, the first of a species in that way. It's been running now for about 2 years successfully and well. This is a completely different process. This is actually the steam methane reformer in Port Arthur, Texas. This has already captured and stored 3 million tons of carbon dioxide at an all-in price of about 10 bucks a ton. It is one of the cheaper options. For some industrial streams, it's actually really cheap and easy to get. And it's worth knowing that this is actually making zero carbon hydrogen at about a buck 80 a gigajoule. This smokes renewable hydrogen by a factor of 4 to 8 today. At today's prices, you can do it already. Useful thing to know. This is the bigger brother of Boundary Dam. This is in Texas. It's a project that I helped launch and the Department of Energy helped finance. This is now completely constructed. It's coming online in the next few months. It'll be fully operational probably around March of 2017. That means we know the costs really well. All-in costs are $100 a ton. All-in costs. Capital, operating expense, storage, transport, the whole kit and caboodle, the costs are $100 a ton. We also know that the next unit will be 20 to 30% cheaper. And that's true at Boundary Dam, that's true at Port Arthur too. When you go from 1 to 2, when N goes from 1 to 2, you typically drop 20 or 30%. And when N gets to 4, you're typically at about 40 or 50% savings. So that means we're in bounds for doing this today at about $50 a ton, and there are already 12 companies around the world that will sell you a unit with a performance guarantee and a wrapper around the whole plant. That's the good news. Another piece of good news, this is happening all around the world. It's a couple of plants going on in the Middle East. Big one in Australia that's coming on next year, 5 million tons of capture and storage a year. We're decarbonizing the oil sands, we're decarbonizing coal to methanol plants in China. There's stuff going on that's meritorious, and many, many countries have embraced this as part of what they need to do. In terms of costs today, people don't tend to see it this way. This is Lazard's latest data. This came out just a few weeks ago. The red bars are what I've added to this. The red bars are my numbers for what the all-in costs are for coal power and natural gas combined cycle. And the cost for those, basically for natural gas combined cycle, you're adding 2 to 2.5 cents per kilowatt hour. For coal, you're adding 3 to 4 cents per kilowatt hour. What you should see from this, though, is that those ranges are in bounds for other clean energy. Most clean energy systems have a range associated with them. That range is a function of technology, resource, market, finance, all kinds of other things. The punchline is that for some areas, this is actually the preferred technology choice. That's the good news. And in fact, if you don't have that technology choice, that means in that market, you will choose a more expensive version, which is why it costs more to decarbonize the world economy without it. As you all know, we don't have much of a budget. If we want to hit 1.5 degrees, we basically got 6 years of emissions. Not very long. A consequence of this is, how will that affect assets like oil fields and coal mines? It turns out the world's economy is built on these things. Pension funds, sovereign wealth funds, retirement funds and so forth, massive investments in equities and stuff are built on the proviso that these fossil energy assets will get done and be used. The governor of the Bank of England kind of threw an elbow recently and said, if that's not the case, once climate change becomes a defining issue, it may already be too late. And he said something interesting here. This oil, gas, and coal will literally be unburnable without the carbon capture technology, which itself alters fossil fuel economics. So this is good to know. And the real issue then, and I'm just going to take a quick step back, if this is basically cost competitive today, why ain't it deployed? And the argument is policy. This is not a technology issue anymore, this is a policy issue. There are renewable portfolio standards, there are feed-in tariffs, there are production tax credits, there are these sorts of things which pay for other kinds of energy but do not pay for carbon capture and storage. I might wish it were otherwise, but that's actually the framework these days. So the good news is a bunch of people have come out and said we need to change that, we need to add policy in order to bring this into the market. Among them, the UNFCCC. The UN Economic Commission on Europe have come out very forcefully and said it is required for us to do this, and therefore it is clean energy to use carbon capture and storage. Among other people who take this opinion, the International Energy Agency, the World Economic Forum, the World Energy Council, others. In the United States, a number of important groups have come out and done this. I'll get to the policies in just a second. This is also a central plank of the Oil and Gas Climate Initiative. You've got 10 independent oil companies or state-owned oil companies, and they've all come out and said, we think natural gas is better than coal and we should all do CCS. More on that in a minute. The IEA has been very particular about this, and in fact, they've laid out a whole set of roles for government around what this looks like. And the punchline is people need to roll up their sleeves and convince governments to enact policies to support this stuff. The way that I tend to describe this, too many Einsteins, not enough Roosevelts. We need to have receptive policymakers for this to be successful, but that starts by making a case. So like I said, policy is required. Incentives work, disincentives work. Carrots work, stick works. In Norway, they have a carbon tax that comes in at about $80 a ton. Not surprisingly, they are the global leader in carbon capture and storage technology. They've actually deployed a number of these things at scale. For 20 years, they've actually been putting CO2 underneath the North Sea because of that tax credit. In terms of incentives, tax credits, feed-in tariffs, contract for differences, carbon trading schemes, state-sponsored strategic projects like China's projects, all of these things are incentives that could get this stuff to market. You have to craft the policy to make it work. The sad case today is that there is no political consequence for saying no to this. If you say no to solar, you get punished. If you say no to natural gas, you get punished. If you say no to nuclear in many countries, you get punished. If you say no to offshore wind, you get dinged. As a politician, if you say no to CCS, nothing happens. It's the first thing chucked overboard. And part of the work needs to be to change that calculus, make it hard for people to say no to this required technology. So what can one do? Let's take a look at the United States. Interestingly, the administration has put forward a whole bunch of ideas. In both the 16 and the 17 budget, and I played some role in this, we proposed investment tax credits and sequestration tax credits that would be like a production tax credit. You get paid for performance, you get paid for the tons underground, and you can take it to the bank. It is also true that under the Clean Power Plan, this is a compliance option for states and listed as such. It is worth knowing that we now have bipartisan and bicameral draft legislation. In the House, Conaway from Texas, or the House Ways and Means Committee, said, let's take an existing tax credit for CCS, 45Q. We're going to make it $30 a ton, no matter what you do with it. Utilization, storage, and historic recovery, doesn't matter. You get $30 a ton, and we're uncapping it. We're making that permanent, and as long as you're doing that, you can get paid. A similar bill has just come out in the House, like last week, or 2 weeks ago. Heidi Heitkamp and Sheldon Whitehouse expanded 45Q tax credits to say $35 for EOR, $50 for geological storage, also uncapped. You get paid for 12 years if you do this, which is something you can then literally take to the bank and get the financing for your project. These are very welcome. There's a completely different pathway Bennett and Portman put forward, which is basically tax-exempt debt financing, private activity bonds, in which they say cost of capital equals zero for your project. That's a way to get these things across the finish line too. All very interesting. There's other things to do. It's worth knowing that Sheldon Whitehouse put report language in my budget, which said, let's do a study on this. That's now in the hands of the National Academy, and they're busily going about writing up a report on this. He also said we need $10 million for better work on carbon utilization, turning CO2 into stuff. We'll come back to that again at the end. He also said $110 million to go in for bioenergy with CCS. Because it's in the coal budget, that requires coal co-firing, but he called out bioenergy with CCS specifically and has proposed in the current draft legislation in the Senate appropriations $110 million to actually do a pilot. So it's starting to move, in part because it's clear now just how far we are from making it. So that means that there's more urgency and people are starting to feel that urgency. Something you might not know is you can monetize this today in California. The low carbon fuel standard credits are trading at about $120 a ton. That is cheaper than this almost everywhere. Right now, our laboratory, National Energy Technology Laboratory, the Department of Energy are all working with the California Air Resources Board to amend their statute so that CCS can be more easily entered into it. It ends up being about the life cycle accounting. That's the right thing to actually think about. But even as of 2006, California recognized that CCS was part of what they needed to do for a low carbon fuel standard, so now they're modifying it so that people can get paid. That's a good thing to do. It's worth knowing that we can do this today for cheap in a bunch of places. In the United States, we've basically got 44 million tons of carbon dioxide that are being emitted essentially as a pure stream. For a price of about $15 a ton, we could capture and store that underground. In some places, you could get paid for it. The 45Q tax credits would make this possible. Immediately, people would start building if they knew they could get paid to put this underground. It's also worth noting that in China, this number is between 180 and 200 million tons a year. Same thing, pure sources of CO2, well within range of a storage site. As I said, it's not just coal technology, and it turns out a lot of companies are working on this. One of the happier things I saw recently was that ExxonMobil decided to partner with Fuel Cell Energy and basically use that fuel cell as an afterburner. They take the emissions coming out of a gas plant, run it into the fuel cell. What comes out the backside of that is more power and concentrated CO2. So basically, Exxon is working to do a demonstration at scale that's vertically integrated, where they sell gas to the power plant, they sell gas to the fuel cell, they capture the CO2 and store it, they control every aspect of the chain. That looks like an Exxon play. That means they're serious. It's worth knowing that all those other companies I talked about, projects I talked about up there, run by Shell, run by Saudi Aramco, run by Statoil, run by Chevron. Like these guys are starting to get it. They understand that the runway for an oil economy is extended by having CCS, and that's actually a useful thing. There's certainly other projects that are working on this too. I'm happy to talk about those technologies in depth later. I'd rather take the last of my time though and talk about negative emissions technologies, which is also, like I said, what we need. So this is from the Center of Carbon Removal. Center for Carbon Removal is a new 501c3 that launched like 2 weeks ago. It's taken them a while to get together. A young, scrappy guy named Noah Deitch, who's done a bunch of these life cycle analyses, basically said, there's a gap and I'm going to fill it. And so he created this organization. And there's basically two different ways you can go about it. The bio stuff and the non-bio stuff. Bio stuff includes things like afforestation, ecosystem restoration, biochar, these sorts of things. The non-bio stuff is the stuff I like because there's still scientific uncertainty around the bio stuff. There's much less scientific uncertainty around the non-bio stuff. There, it's hard engineering, and you have a meter that goes underground or that measures the volume of stuff coming out so you know exactly how much CO2 is stored and used. Bioenergy with CCS is the Russian tractor in this design. It will never cost more than that. If you do bioenergy with CCS, even at small scale, even at crazy prices, it won't cost more than that to decarbonize the atmosphere. So we have a kind of an urgency to get a pilot up here demonstrating that we can do this. Direct air capture is something similar. We know we can pull CO2 out of the air. We know because plants do it. We know because submarines and spaceships do it. Those costs are about $1,000 a ton. No one wants to pay that, but people are coming on doing better stuff. You can also accelerate natural systems. That's enhanced weathering. This is how nature pulls CO2 out of the air, as we've learned in ice ages and so forth. If you can speed that up using enzymes or chemical processes, then you've got work to do, and that's also good. And you can turn CO2 into stuff. Maybe you can turn it into cement, maybe you can turn it into plastics, maybe you can turn it into liquid fuels. Whatever it is, if you can turn that CO2 into a thing, then you're actually working in a negative emissions framework. This is the range of what's possible here. Again, not geoengineering, just engineering. It's worth noting there is no national R&D program anywhere in the world on this. Shame on us. That's more that we should be doing. I wanted to take a moment and dwell on this. This paper came out very recently, last week in Nature. If you didn't catch it, this is the best graph to communicate this I've ever seen. We've got 2 degrees over here, 1.5 degrees over there, and the INDCs mapped on it. Basically, if we hit our INDCs under all these scenarios, we must have large volumes of negative emissions. And if we actually want to live in a 1.5 degree world, by 2050, we need a bunch of negative emission stuff. By 2060, we're talking 10 gigatons a year of negative emissions, which, as you know, is just a huge, 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 huge amount. That means that we really need to be fielding this stuff in 20 years. Not a lot of time. So I feel urgent, and I'm a busy guy these days. It's worth knowing, though, there's people who have been working on this for a while. The best time to plant a tree is 10 years ago, and a number of people did that. One of these is the Archer Daniels Midland Project. This is an ethanol plant, just conventional corn ethanol. But what they're doing is they're taking the concentrated CO2 from the fermenter and they're putting it underground. They've already stored 1 million tons of this. They're working up towards 1 million tons a year. That should come online in a couple of months. And that will cut the carbon footprint of that biofuel by 50%. So that's useful. There's also a couple of companies pulling the stuff out of the air. Carbon Engineering in British Columbia, Klimaworks in Switzerland, and in both cases, they're basically taking some hardened technology, pulling CO2 out of the air, and doing something with it. This is, again, sort of, it doesn't get more expensive than this approach. This gives you technical finding and room to grow, and I'm happy to talk more about those technologies going forward. I do want to say that, again, we already know that we can do better than this, and the reason why is because natural systems already do better than this. So let me tell you some of the things that we're working on at Livermore. One of the things we've learned is that you can take a 3D printer, you can print bespoke reactors, and it turns out that you can print enzymes and catalysts in them. So that means that what you have here is not a gas exchanger, you actually have a reactor. You can actually convert the CO2 into other things using a permeable membrane. That's a lovely thing to do, and you can either take an existing enzyme or you can use the active site as that enzyme as a model and then do in silico design of a new substance. We are printing cells as well. We're not just printing catalysts and enzymes. That's a cartilage being printed over there. We've now at the point where we can print living cells in these things and let them do work too. So things that convert CO2 to other things, we can make a device out of them. We can microstructure these things to any level that we want to. What you're looking at here is about, the spacing on those things is about 50 microns. So we can make these things at the dimensions of your lungs, 100 microns for our alveoli. And again, functionalize them. You can put catalysts and enzymes and high surface area electrodes and all these other things. You can design them this way. You can either do that with a chaotic foam or with a textured foam, and we can just make these things to our specifications these days. Or we can make artificial cells. That's what I call these microencapsulated solutions. You basically make a little plastic permeable membrane, you put something that works either in the membrane or in the center, and you're done. So we're starting to be able to hack these systems in a way that makes them interesting. Ultimately, what we'd like to be able to do is this, and this is my last slide. You'd like to be able to turn the CO2 back into fuels, because the transportation system is the hard part, specifically J8 for jet planes, or diesel for transoceanic barges. The hard to scrub parts of the economy require something like CO2 utilization. So there's multiple pathways to go down here. But what you really need is you need catalysts. There's no commercially available process. So we need thermal catalysts, electrical catalysts, chemical catalysts, photocatalysts to do this work. The good news is people have just begun now, including people here, to start developing and demonstrating these things. With that, I'll turn it over to Alyssa.
Clearly a lot of science that can produce some good stuff later, but the real big issue, I think, is the how to get the policy environment in a way that the existing technologies, even like CCS, will really get going. If that's a reasonable summary of what you said. Thank you. Alyssa.
So it was great to have Julio give an overview first, because he dealt with the large scale of CCS and CCUS issues until now. And what I want to do today, just 10-minute brief introduction on what kind of technologies are behind on CCS, and as well as what he talked about, the utilization side of it, which we are really starting recently. Can you hear me without it? Are you okay? Okay. All right, and then I want to also highlight some of the research at going on at Columbia. We had a lot of great breakthroughs recently. So, before I start, I'm a faculty member in Earth and Environmental Engineering and Chemical Engineering, and as well as the Lenfest Center Sustainable Energy, I'm the director of. So we do a lot of research in these areas. So, go back. So, as Julio mentioned, we've been working in this area last two decades or so, how to capture CO2, and a lot of these technologies mimic the natural process. We just want to help that particular process a little faster, because if it is slow, it means the big reactors, capital investment will be really high, and you can really have a space in power plant or chemical plants to install those CO2 capture units. So we've been working on how to make it go fast. Means that CO2, acidic gas, you need a base, right? So if you have a really strong base, you can capture CO2 very quickly. The problem is it's always two sets, because any capture materials, you don't want to use once and throw it away, right? Because it would be very, very expensive. So you want to capture it once and regenerate so that you can keep circulating, so that initial cost of capture material goes into the noise. That's the whole point. When we were looking at it, when you have a strong base, you can do capture very easily, but you have to put a lot more energy to regenerate the solvent, right? At the same time, if you have really weak base, then capture will be challenged, but regeneration will be easy. So they're looking at this balance, people start looking into a few of the functional groups they really liked, and one of them is amine functional groups. So for example, MEA, which is monoethanolamine, is one of the technologies a lot of these demonstration projects are using. So it's good enough to capture and good enough to regenerate during the regeneration section here. Reaction kinetic is very good. So you can capture with decent size. It's still big, but decent size. But the problem is the parasitic energy consumption of this entire process, especially here where you have to put energy in to kick off the CO2 and regenerate your solvent was very high. So particularly in the United States, our power plant efficiency is not that high. It's about 34 to 36%. And what we are anticipating that was you having this technology installed, you reduce your power plant efficiency by one third. That's tremendous, right? And then you still have to control mercury and many other things to come along. So can we really afford to do that? That was a big challenge. But still, if we have to do it today, and if we do it today, this is the technology we'll do because we know a lot of know-how. There are other technologies. This is NETL, usually publishes every few years. These are the more futuristic technologies versus the what we are known is amine solvent. So a lot of people have been working in this area, but one of the reasons why this parasitic energy consumption is high is these monoethanolamine or amine-based materials cannot be used as a pure form. So usually have to be diluted with water. So maximum concentration is about 38%, which means that you have to, there's a lot of water going along the ride. So you heat up the water to 120, 140 degrees C, cool it down very quickly to 40 to 60 degrees C, going back and forth. That takes a lot of energy. So next challenge for these CO2 capture units using amine-based solvent, you really need to look at how to smartly heat integrate the heat and use waste heat and so on. If you do that each time, you can reduce the parasitic energy consumption. So good area to be in. But there are other people start looking into, well, can we use amine functional groups without any water, if that's the issue? So this is more futuristic because we're just scratching the surface on this technology last 5-6 years or so. So there are many groups, and most of these projects were funded out of ARPA-E, which was more high-risk, high-return kind of projects. And some of the examples are ionic liquid from University of Notre Dame is doing really well, and Chinese groups are doing really well in this area. These are the ionic materials can have decorated with a lot of amine functional groups without having any water. So that's pretty good. Interesting thing about this particular material has no vapor pressure. So you can heat it up to 120 degrees C and 40 degrees C, 140, without worrying about compressing the reactor itself. So that gives another benefit in terms of designing a reactor system at the beginning. There are other technologies like a cobalt or phase changing by GE. I won't go into too much detail. But at Columbia, I'm working with Cornell University on developing new material based on nanotechnology. This material is called liquid-like nanoparticle organic hybrid materials. We call it NOMS. It's very similar to basically mimicry of ionic liquid, but you can make it much easier based on the commodity polymers, which is decorated with amine functional groups. By tethering the polymers onto nanoparticle, you can basically eliminate almost reduce the vapor pressure up to 300-350 degrees C, almost negligible, which is very unique. And chemical physical tunability is great. So we've been working in this area for many years. So we are really learning about chemistry and physics of these materials, how they interact with CO2, and seems to be have a great capture capacity, and there are a lot of benefits. And parasitic energy consumption, if you're looking at these materials, it will be significantly lower than aqueous base. The problem, a lot of people get criticized, most of us are working in the lab with a very, very tiny milliliter or less of materials. Of course, it works well in that level, right? You can put it into FTIR, you can do all kinds of measurement. But once start to thinking about putting this in what the photos of Julio showed, and you are trying to pump these materials in large quantity, there are other problems. So for example, ionic liquid and gnomes, this material is thousands times higher viscosity than water. Beyond 20 centipoise, there's no reason for you to try to even pump this material. So that became biggest challenge for second generation CO2 capture materials. So did we give up? Well, not particularly, because there are some benefits of this technology. So third generation we are looking at, which is kind of started last year from the paper done by colleagues of Julio at Lawrence Livermore, is Roger Ains' group published in Nature Communications, saying that, well, if you have viscous material, you will have mass transfer problems. So can we just increase the surface area by providing some artificial surface? So what we are doing, working with Livermore and other groups, anybody who has a high viscosity CO2 capture materials, now putting them into encapsulated material, which is this outer shell has gas permeability. So you can capture CO2. Now your liquid material has no vapor pressure, so you can put it into any system. Now it's a gas solid system, behaving like a gas solid system. So you can put it into duct, you can do all kinds of application. So this is one of the ways to innovatively overcoming novel material challenges. So these are kind of new areas a lot of people are moving into, and a lot of funding, some of the funding at least, going in from the DOE right now. But after capturing CO2, what would you do, right? And I think some of the discussion already happened in the morning. You can store CO2 underground. And that's where we particularly started most of the groups, tried to mimic nature, because we can't really build large enough storage tank for all the CO2 we're going to collect. And based on the weight Julio was talking about, definitely not, right? So if you inject CO2, what would happen to CO2 in geological formations? And this is the plot IPCC 2005 special report said, well, depending on what you have, there will be a structural storage trapping, residual trapping, and solubility ones, and then you will be going along the timeline. And it really depends on the geological formation, right, and conditions. But if you have reactive formation, you can even have mineral trapping, means that you will have accelerated carbonation of some silicate minerals. So now you're pushing Earth to do something they're not particularly used to. So what would happen? So there's a good collaboration at Columbia, which is very unique here, that engineers are working with the Earth scientists trying to answer these questions. And this is one of the latest, a very new publication. We just came out from Lamont. This is not my work, but I was kind of offsite participating this. First author is a young martyr who used to be here at Lamont, and now he's at University of Southampton. And Martin Stu is also co-author on this, and he's member of our Lamfest Center for Sustainable Energy. They thought if we inject these materials in basalt formation, then eventually it will carbonate. It will be great for the long-term storage. And we thought it would take years and years and years, and a lot of simulation says it will take decades and 100 years, right? But when we actually inject it in Iceland, this is Carbfix project, and then you can find their paper in Science recently published about a month ago or so. Anyway, they were able to find these carbonates. In fact, we used the two different tracers, like SF6 and carbon-14, CO2, right? And then when we came out in the well, what we observed was SF6 came back, but not carbon-14. They gave us what happened to CO2, and it was really amazing to see that mere very few months to a year period of time, it was carbonated into solid. So based on that, a lot of people start looking to, well, can we do more of these other places? Definitely, there's a plenty of silicate rock formations. You can use that. Some people even use the chemistry alkalinity of seawater to do that. But we also have a lot of industries has these industrial high alkalinity waste streams in these chemical industries. And interestingly, these chemical industries are the ones emit most CO2. So using their own waste, you cannot 100% capture and store CO2. You can't, because it's not enough. But at least they can offset a little bit. So we are working with Baotou Steel, which is the largest steel company in China, because they're not particularly interested in carbon issue yet. But they have a huge issue of solid management, solid waste management. So we're trying to use that CO2 can be used to treat your waste stream. So in a kind of funny way, they're leading in that effort right now. So what are the challenges? These materials are usually not leaching this magnesium or calcium that rapidly. So we use a lot of ligands or catalysts to make that go fast. I won't go into detail. But overall process, what we are looking at is that although if you have basing material like the serpentine or magnesium silicate minerals or alkaline steel slag or fly ash, it should react with CO2. It will if you leave it long enough, but we don't have time. So what we do is we put it into a contact with the strong acid and then leach out the calcium and magnesium, and then we carbonate separately so that the whole reaction goes super fast. You can definitely do that. And if you do it in the reactor as ex situ, you can even control the final product. We can put it into market. Of course, you don't want to do too much because you will flood the market, but at the same time, this is kind of low-hanging fruit. You can really offset carbon footprint. So what else can we do? This is the map they came up with. If once you capture CO2 from power plants or any point sources, or you can even do it from direct air capture, right? Because this particular CO2 doesn't really matter where it came from, then you can use it for many different ways. First, you can use it as it is, as a working fluid for getting more oil out of the ground, or you can even get more shale out of the ground. We can debate whether it's a good idea or not, but at least you can definitely do that. And a lot of people are working in this area because particularly in China, they don't have any water to do fracking, and their shale is a lot deeper. But other areas people are particularly interested, as Julio mentioned, there are a lot of chemicals and fuels we can make. But because CO2 is a lower energy level than all these things, you need energy, which is carbon-free energy. So that goes into this research, right? I think sometimes in our areas, we got criticized. We are against renewable energy. I don't think so, because if you agree that not only we have to do zero emission, but we have to now even go to negative emission, means that we really have to work with renewable energy. The day when renewable energy is cheap and abundant, we can do all kinds of things, managing carbon. So if we have intermittent this renewable energy, solar or wind, we can put CO2 back into the work so that we don't take any more carbon out of the ground, or you can actually put it back. So there are a few options. Bioenergy is considered to be carbon negative. You can do CCS on top, so it becomes negative. Waste to energy is another one. If you're going to landfill, might as well use it for something, getting more energy, and then do CCS. Or direct air capture, actually harvesting CO2 from low dense concentration. So this is some of the examples of what people have been working on. There were some photos Julio showed, but this is our colleague who used to be at Columbia, Klaus Lochner. I'm sure many of you know. He's working on this pretty picture, to get to this pretty picture, right? And right now he's in the lab scale, but his material uses, try to use energy from environment so that you put minimum carbon associated energy into this CCS scheme. Okay, so this is the overall picture I want to show for what we do at LEMFA Center. At the end of the day, I think we far past point of return, right? Which means that we need to do CCS from point sources for sure, but we also have to plan for the long term, how we're going to do negative so that we can go back to our historic emission and get rid of it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Alyssa, and I hope in the discussion we can come back to some of these fascinating ideas, but the time scales and some of the risks and impacts elsewhere, something to think about. But anyway, I would now ask Phil Rash, I hope he's connected, to make a presentation.
I was asked to tell you a little bit about solar radiation management. It's a term which was developed about 10 years ago at this point in the game. Sometimes with our tongue in cheek, it's also called sunlight reflection methods. And it essentially refers to the idea of reducing the amount of sunlight that warms the planet slightly to compensate for the warming that we get from an increase in greenhouse gases. So I'm going to just try and spend a few minutes telling you what it's all about and maybe where some of the challenges are as well on it. It's also called climate intervention, and I'm pointing here on the right to a report that was written by the National Academy. I was a co-author on this last year, and it's in your Google folders that you could look at if you wanted to. I explain what geoengineering is, and we've already talked a bit about that. And there are also, if you care to look at this, you will it'll show you where there are some other resources that you can go to if you wish to know more about it. So the basic idea is that the Earth's surface gets cooler when a cloud goes overhead, we've observed that the Earth could cool for other reasons as well. And what has been proposed is to introduce a layer of aerosols at high altitudes in the atmosphere, at around 20 kilometers in altitude, that are analogs of the natural aerosols which reside there at all times at low amplitudes and sometimes at high amplitudes after a volcanic eruption. These aerosols can then scatter some of the sunlight back to space and prevent it from warming the planet. Or else, another strategy which has been suggested is to increase the reflectivity of cloud systems. And I'll spend a little bit of time telling you about each of these. So one of the reasons why we scientists think that this will work is because we have observational records which suggest that there is a cooling which follows volcanic eruptions. And I'm showing you here in the lower panel a time history of the temperature change with respect to the early 1990s that occurred following an eruption by Pinatubo in the middle of 1991, which indicated that the black line here is showing you an observational estimate or a couple of them. The red lines are models attempting to reproduce the same signature. What one saw was that over the course of about a year, the planet cooled by half a degree following the eruption of Pinatubo. This estimate has subsequently been agreed might be a slight overestimate of the amount of cooling that actually occurred. It could be somewhat less than that. 3 or 4 tenths of a degree Kelvin might be a more accurate estimate. So unlike the previous couple of talks that you heard, which were by specialists in engineering, I'm a modeler, a climate modeler, and we have attempted to explore some of these consequences in climate models, and they're discussed in this report I referred you to. And what I'm showing you here is a result of the temperature change that one would see over the planet following a quadrupling of carbon dioxide in a scenario where there was no geoengineering, and then in a scenario where sunlight was reduced by a few percent uniformly over the planet in an attempt to mimic the behavior of the aerosols that would the stratospheric aerosols that might occur following an eruption, although these aerosols would be continually injected rather than to occur only one time. So the amount of aerosols that are suggested might be appropriate to produce the kind of cooling that we see here are maybe 2 Pinatubos per year, or maybe more than that, maybe 4 Pinatubos for a quadrupling of CO2. The response to the planet is nonlinear, and the more aerosols that you introduce into the atmosphere, the less effect that they have. So there are models estimate a variety of different amounts, and these are one of the uncertainties that remain in the exploration of these concepts in climate models. In this case, what we've done is to just essentially turn the amplitude of the sunlight down, but more realistic experiments have been made, model experiments have been made, in which we introduce a fleet of aircraft which which inject sulfur species into the atmosphere at around 20 kilometers in altitude in the tropics, and other simulations have been made where we've introduced them at other places, like over the Arctic, or in an attempt to reduce the impact in the high latitudes only, and preserve sea ice, for example. So what you'll see is, in the presence of geoengineering, that it's possible to cool the planet substantially, returning it to temperatures which are approximately the same as an unperturbed, a pre-industrial amount of CO2 in the atmosphere. The temperatures are about within a half a degree of that reference state. But at high latitudes, particularly in the winter time, you'll see that the temperatures remain somewhat warmer than in the pre-industrial times, but it's a much reduced temperature change compared to that you would encounter with this quite dramatic increase in CO2 of four times pre-industrial amounts. So there are more consequences to the introduction of this kind of a aerosol to the planet, other than just the annual average values. And we've explored, many scientists have explored consequences to a variety of locations around the planet, and explored it for more than just temperature change. I'm showing you here also precipitation, and these bar charts are measuring the, or are trying to characterize the amplitude of the temperature change at these particular locations compared to the sort of natural variability of the temperature field or the precipitation field for present day conditions. So the implication is, for example, that over Alaska and northwestern Canada, in a doubled CO2 scenario, this modeling study suggested that the temperature change might be twice that experienced with respect to natural variability. And when one introduces the geoengineering into the planet, there is a slight cooling of a few hundredths of a degree Kelvin. Similarly, it's anticipated that for precipitation distributions with a doubling of CO2, you would see increases in precipitation in many places around the planet. But when one introduces the geoengineering, shown in the red bars here, there is a reduction in precipitation, although the perturbation with respect to the model suggests that the perturbations with respect to the ambient variations in precipitation are substantially smaller than one would see if one doesn't employ a geoengineering strategy. There are also other ways that we can cool the planet, and one of the things that scientists are focusing a great deal of attention on now is the ways that aerosol pollution particles can act to cool the planet. It ends up that these aerosol particles scatter sunlight back to space directly, but they also affect clouds that in turn can scatter sunlight, and they can have effects on the amount of CO2 that are drawn up by the atmosphere as well. And one example of the impact that aerosols can have on clouds is seen in this satellite picture showing the cloud distribution off the coast of California. These white streaks that you see are so-called ship tracks, which are places where the clouds have become brighter after a freighter has passed along the surface, introducing pollution particles that are the consequences of burning fossil fuel. So this is a very dramatic example of the ways in which clouds might be brightened. And scientists have also speculated about the possibility of doing this deliberately rather than inadvertently as a mechanism for cooling the planet. It ends up that rather modest changes in the cloud distributions could produce significant changes in the energy budget of the planet and also be able to cool the potentially to cool the Earth. So it ends up that there are clouds respond differently to the introduction of aerosols, and a variety of people have now done studies about where clouds might be most susceptible to the introduction of these aerosols. And some of those regions are shown here in bright red. They tend to be the areas of a kind of a low-level persistent cloud decks called marine stratocumulus that exist off the coast of the United States and Chile and Peru, off the in the off the western edge of Australia, and there's also a system that exists off the coast of Africa as well. So in the subtropics. And I think I'm going to skip this in the interest of keeping the presentation sort of short. There are, by introducing these changes into the atmosphere, into a model atmosphere, we see changes in the precipitation distribution. And this slide is really meant to communicate to you that these precipitation distributions are very difficult to handle accurately in climate models, and the answers are ambiguous when you compare one model result to another. We've also explored the impact of those these kind of geoengineering strategies on sea ice distributions, and I'm showing you here three different scenarios. The top row are showing you the summertime sea ice decreases, so a reduction in sea ice fraction by 50% or more is shown in blue in the summertime in the southern hemisphere and the northern hemisphere for a doubling of CO2. But when we introduce geoengineering strategies, these strong reductions are ameliorated significantly. It's actually possible by reflecting a sufficient amount of sunlight to overcompensate for the sea ice reductions and to produce in some regions too much sea ice, if you believe the models. There are also impacts on the oceans, and I think I'm going to dispense with this slide as well in the interest of time. But I will show you this one and spend a few minutes telling you about it. What I'm showing you here are, the impact of a doubling of CO2 compared to a reference simulation for, in this case, this is called a meridional stream function showing you the ocean circulation that is occurring when in a scenario where CO2 has been doubled. And I don't want to spend very much time on the top panel, but we'll point out that on the lower panel, what I'm showing you are the changes in the circulation features, and the bright purple regions and the orange regions here are showing you where there are significant changes in this circulation features globally and in the Atlantic. And the message is that there are changes in these ocean currents that occur at medium and high latitudes in the northern hemisphere or in the southern hemisphere when CO2 is doubled. The right panels are showing you the similar figures when we've introduced geoengineering. And in this case, the message is that many of the northern hemisphere ocean circulation changes have been mitigated, but the southern hemisphere circulation changes have not. And this is due to the fact that the circulation features that are driving this are driven very strongly by what's going on in the stratosphere. And the solar the sunlight reduction methods are not capable of attenuating or mitigating those changes that are occurring in circulation features in the stratosphere, which eventually are communicated to the ocean. This is another study which shows some impacts on sea ice, and I think I can dispense with it as well and move on to my take-home messages and talking points. So these strategies for geoengineering the planet are discomforting for scientists as well, and our first choice is always to stop producing CO2 or to reduce and continue to draw down CO2, as you've heard about in the previous presentations. But nevertheless, it appears that sunlight reduction methods are an imperfect but effective method for cooling the planet. They do have positive implications for precipitation, sea ice distributions, and temperature. And I'm going to transition at this point to just say that, of course, all the results that I've shown you, except the results associated with volcanic eruptions, are modeling results. And there are many remaining uncertainties about how accurate the important processes are that are being modeled in, and that are important for determining the response of the climate system. So it's quite important, I think, for us to consider the possibility, if one wants to consider the use of geoengineering, to begin to consider deploying very small field studies, which can initially attempt to confirm our capabilities of representing these processes and models and make sure that they're behaving correctly. It would be not only important for the understanding of the consequences of these sorts of changes to the total climate system, but it's also quite in the presence of geoengineering, but it's also quite important for understanding the basic processes of that determine much of our climate in the atmosphere. So we could, for example, we have proposed to do field studies which might allow us to make sure that the treatments of clouds' responses to the introduction of aerosols are accurate. And then lastly, I'm going to just remind the audience that there are many issues of concern in using these methods. We're uncertain about the impacts of the changes. We haven't looked at all of them, that's for sure. Many of the strategies are currently limited by unfamiliar and unquantifiable risks. The governance issues are, of course, often important. There is concern among scientists, society in general, and philosophers and ethicists about a so-called slippery slope, that just considering these issues makes them more palatable. And, of course, I think all of us are in agreement that the most desirable outcome is to reduce CO2 concentrations in the atmosphere. I've already talked to you about unexplored scientific issues, and I list a few of them in this last bulleted item. We know about consequences to ozone. We speculate about potential consequences to ecosystems, secondary effects on climate circulations, the occurrences of fires at high latitudes, for example, by changing precipitation distributions and melting of permafrost and peat, changes to the moisture of peat, for example. All of these things have not yet been investigated. And I will close there.
Thank you, Phil. Fascinating, and lots of issues that we can come back to in our discussion. So now let's quickly get to our last speaker, Silmon Tilmes.
So what I want to talk about is something that kind of summarizes what we have heard about. We're talking about a scenario that includes the carbon dioxide removal as well as solar radiation management. And the title is Climate Impacts of Geoengineering and a Delayed Mitigation Scenario.
So we'll say, what would have happened, or what would happen if until 2040, nothing has been done yet in terms of really ambitious mitigation, and we're reaching a time where surface temperature trends are, or global surface temperature reach already 2 degrees. So as you see in my first slide on the left, there are temperature, surface temperatures in winter, and we see the trends are most dramatic also over the Arctic. And looking in the future, we see that it's not getting better, but actually worse. The trends are increasing. And people at that point decided in politics that something has to be done right now. At that point, though, we are at a 2 degree warming. And so what can be done at this point to stabilize the climate if we just do large scale decarbonization? And the other question
I'm sorry to interrupt, but I can't see the slides. I don't know, can the rest of the audience see them? Okay. I don't need to see.
Okay, you can look at the Google folder, I think. Okay, so what can we do at this point? We already reached 2 degrees, and the option is to include solar radiation management to maybe keep the temperatures at 2 degrees. And question also is how much solar radiation management would be necessary, and what are the impacts compared to a low carbon scenario that people are describing as RCP 2.6 earlier. We call it early decarbonization scenario, but as we have heard before, this is already a bit too late because we are above the emissions that are suggested for that scenario. So what we have done is we're using a simple climate model and integrated science assessment model to design a scenario. I'm sorry, I skipped a few slides. Oops. I hope you can see the right slide right now, which is the scenario development slide. Okay. And so what we do, we start in 2040 and assume that now action is taken. As we have heard in the first two talks, decarbonization is taking into place. In the first 10 years, we have a transition period up to 2050, and then we really go down with CO2 emissions here and reaching in 2095 even negative emissions, going up to 2200. What if we look at the CO2 concentrations, we will still, though, even doing that in 2040, reach up to 600 ppm by the end of the 21st century, and then slowly trending down here as the black line. And if we look at temperature now, reaching the 2 degrees, such an overshoot scenario would reach up to 2 degrees and then would go down. So if we delay our action till 2040, the only way to actually reach a 2-degree target is to use other measures like what Phil has described, solar radiation management. One example is applying injections of sulfate of SO2 and forming sulfate aerosols in the stratosphere. And that could basically shave off the peak. The idea of this study was also to look at a more reasonable, likely scenario, because geoengineering in a sense of injecting sulfate particles, if you would do it at a scenario like an 8.5 scenario where the greenhouse gases always increase, you would always have to add more and more aerosols into the stratosphere, but never see the end in the tunnel, basically, or the light at the end of the tunnel. But doing a scenario where we actually end up eventually stopping this intervention again was the idea. So we put this in a global climate model in the CSM at ANCA, the Community Earth System Model, which has all kind of interaction included. And we started in 2040 and then included these emissions, the CO2 concentration derived by the simple climate model. And then we also estimated how much sulfate aerosols we would need and how strong the forcing has to be to get down to either 2.5 or 2 degrees C of warming compared to pre-industrial. So these are our simulations. The late decarbonization pathway is the black one here. Then we have a SSI, which means stratospheric SO2 injection scenario reaching 2.5 C, and then a scenario SSI that reached 2 degrees. And we compare that to the RCP 2.6 or the early decarbonation scenario. And so what is the SO2 that would be required? Estimating it from a distribution of aerosols that we have and we can apply to the model, and estimating how much forcing basically a certain aerosol amount would be, we can estimate in this model that we would need a lot of injection of SO2. So what you see here on the left top is the sulfur burden in teragram sulfur, or gigaton sulfur if you have the same unit as the CO2 earlier. The black lines are the past volcanic eruptions, and the latest ones was the Mount Pinatubo. So this is the amount of stratospheric sulfur burden that we observed or estimated. The red line shows how much sulfur burden we would need for a 2 degree case, or a little less, of course, because we want less reduction of the warming for the 2.5 degree scenario. In terms of injection, that is a huge amount. It would reach up to 18 gigatons per year. If we still consider, this is still a small part of what is actually injected in the troposphere every year in sulfur. Now, running it in the model, I go to the next slide. You see that the global mean surface temperature, we can actually reach what we plan to reach for surface global surface temperature. The red line is the RCP 8.5. We reach 4.7 about C at the end of the 21st century. Our overshoot scenario does follow what we expected, and we reach a top temperature increase up to 3 degrees C, and then a slow decline into the 22nd century. By the end of the 22nd century, we have, again, 2 degrees. And also our combined CDR and solar radiation cases can actually produce a scenario, the SSI 2.0, that is very similar to the RCP 2.5 scenario. But this is really now the starting point of what we can look at, question, what are the impacts and what are the differences of these different scenarios? And in this presentation, I could talk for much longer. I can talk about other things. We have looked at precipitation, aridity, but I want to focus on temperatures, because this is the question on the Arctic, and what you see is surface temperature change between 2070, 29, and then present day, or 1966 to 2005. So the change really by the end of the 21st century for different seasons, and the different lines show you the different scenarios that we have chosen. So in the RCP 8.5 world, where the global warming is about 5 degrees C, the surface temperature in the Arctic warms way higher, and it's not 5 C in our simulation, but this is a different baseline probably, or it is going quite high. And the highest warming is always in fall and winter, where the less strong warming is in spring and summer here. But when you look at the impact, or the what we can achieve with geoengineering, the orange line shows that if we do cool the global climate to 2 degrees, we almost reach temperature increases that can be achieved in an early mitigation scenario, so a scenario that would have already started. One point also here is that you see that the SSI 2.5 is not that much, not so far away in terms of warming in the Arctic. But now if we actually look at the Northern Hemisphere September sea ice evolution, and the red is again the RCP 8.5, we see how the sea ice has dropped up to 2040. And then when we start our overshoot scenario, this is not enough to actually save the sea ice in a way, and it really drops. Although, as you may remember, we are a little lower in this scenario than maybe the global average mean, but nevertheless, we do reach very low values in the late decarbonization pathway. And even if we would put a lot of sulfur into the stratosphere and cool up to 2.5 degrees, we still cannot save it in that way as we could if we just go to 2 degrees C. So there seems to be a large sensitivity on the temperature in the Arctic to actually keep sea ice at a certain level or stabilize it, at least to the values we had in 2040. We cannot increase this in this model, in this case, but at least we stabilize this. And for my conclusions, I would say starting decarbonization, at the time when 2 degrees C has been already reached, that would only be possible to use solar radiation management or some form of geoengineering over a long time, and we estimate that has to be about 160 years in this case. In our model, we see a stabilization of sea ice, but we don't see it recover. And the point is, though, that this is just one scenario, of course. And possible scenarios could be thought of, for instance, starting earlier, starting at a time when actually we reach 1.5 degrees C, what would happen probably would require to start in this model at 2020 or 2030, if even possible. The other thing is that this is one model study, and hopefully this can motivate other model studies to also look and identify the whole range of possible impacts and side effects that Phil also has talked about. Okay, with this, I want to stop. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Simone, and thank you to all the speakers. And we have about 40 minutes for discussion. I must say, if I were the Arctic, I would be really depressed right now. So in spite of some of the positive things that we have heard, it doesn't look so good. So anyway, I'm sure there'll be lots of questions, comments. Please identify yourself and try to specifically ask a question from one of the speakers or make a very brief comment. And I've seen Scott right in front of me. So.
Thank you very much. This question is for Julio and Alyssa. I'm Scott Stevenson, University of Connecticut. Actually, I have two questions. One is, are there any geological strata that completely preclude the locating of or the implementation of CCS? I'm thinking about the fact that there are a lot of factors that go into the location of a factory or facility in a particular place. So is it just not possible in some areas because of the geology? And number two, why haven't we seen any push for a policy incentive for implementing CCS from coal states like West Virginia? Or maybe we have, and I'm just not aware of it.
So a couple of quick thoughts. First of all, yes, there are certainly parts of the globe where you simply can't do carbon capture and storage. The most unfortunate of these is Japan. Japan, Korea basically don't have places to store CO2. Central India, no place to store CO2. But most countries that matter, the United States, Canada, Australia, China, northern India, where most of the coal plants are, and actually both eastern and western India as well, these are places that are perfectly well suited to store CO2. In general, a challenge that you can pick up for some of these countries like India is you just need a longer pipeline. We've already got 5,000 miles of CO2 pipeline in the United States. We kind of have a feeling for what that stuff costs. A big pipeline rolls out to be between $1 and $2 a ton. So it's a small lever on the cost of doing this. It is true, though, that the characterization of a storage site and the drilling and assessment and the pipelines are all upfront capital costs. And it's hard to get those back in the market. And if you're staring at a $70 million capital expense and you don't know if your storage site will be good or not, not a lot of people want to make those investments. Just recently, the Department of Energy has created a program and a solicitation specifically to do site characterization at that level of fidelity, knowing that eventually we'll be doing carbon capture and storage. They want a handful of sites around the country that have been pre-characterized. With respect to coal states or fossil heavy states versus not. It's helpful to know that 20% of people don't take their medicine as prescribed by their doctor. So when it directly affects their health and they've already paid the money and they have it in their hands, they still don't take their medicine. This is just humans act certain ways. My experience has been in dealing with members of Congress and their staff at the rank and file member, at the committee chair level, there's actually a great deal of enthusiasm for CCS. Part of the issue, though, is Senate and House leadership are grappling with issues of total cost. They've kind of laid their sort of sequestration budget level as the thing that shan't be exceeded, and that creates unfortunate politics, zero-sum games, all these other sorts of things. We unfortunately find ourselves in a world where even just discussing the phrase climate change has become polarized. Would it were otherwise, but it's actually real. And what we have seen is if we don't work with the right, we don't make progress. I take heart, though, this last round of bills that I was talking about, 45Q tax credits, from Texas, North Dakota, Kentucky, and West Virginia. Those are the primary sponsors. We're starting to finally see some action here. And when I was at headquarters, my budget went up 30%, and the appropriators were from Kentucky, Pennsylvania, and Kentucky. So we're starting to see some traction around these issues in a positive way.
So just add a little bit to what Julio said. So there's a new call just came out, and in fact, Colombia will be bidding on that too, because we have a lot of effort there. Because the regional issues, all these carbon sequestration, when it started about a decade ago, it was a regional partnership. So they're trying to deal with the different formations, what options available. So I think some of these first two phases are already done, and they're going to do next phase 1 through 4. So hopefully from there, we're going to get more ideas. There are some projects, like, for example, in Florida, some of our collaborators at Research Triangle Institute are trying to capture CO2 and inject. But there's EPA regulation changed the last minute so that they weren't allowed to inject. So I think there's a regulation. We are still trying to sort it out. So now they're doing catch and release, unfortunately. But another thing they found out there is that the monitoring cost is very expensive. So each well might cost like $1 million per year, and this is indefinite maintaining cost. So that has to be dealt with, of course, insurance costs and all that, so on. So how long are we going to guarantee all those things are an issue? Another issue people don't usually talk about, but a lot of geothermal energy fields are talking about, is if you inject any fluid at high pressure, 150 atmospheric pressure or something like that, you will create an earthquake. The question is it going to be a big one and compressed, or is it going to be very little manageable ones? So site-specific, so we have to do a lot of that. And in Switzerland, they did one of the studies working with public. They were okay with the 3.4 earthquake. I was surprised. So depending on how you do it, apparently. So they were very upfront about it, but definitely it does come. So how it's going to behave, it's really hard to tell. But there were a lot of know-how from industry already. Like he was saying, Statoil did a lot of injection. Other companies have done it too. So I think if we share a lot of data and then try to figure out what is the important questions we need to ask for each of the sites, and how much monitoring is required for each of the sites, all these things will make it easier for us to actually do it in large scale.
Just a quick follow-on on that. People don't know this. Today we are injecting 100 million tons of carbon dioxide a year into the ground, and the earthquake magnitude that tends to be at the upper end of this is a magnitude 1, 1.5. You can't actually feel it at the surface. The risks associated with seismicity are actually well-recognized, well-conscienced, and manageable. So I would prefer that you guys don't walk out there saying, earthquakes, big deal. We actually do this well today and manage the earthquakes substantively and easily.
I think that's why it's good to be open with it. This can happen, and this is the measures we're going to take to make sure that it doesn't happen in a negative way. I think that's important. And another thing is a place like Oman, we do a lot of research from Lamont there. They don't produce CO2, but there's a lot of sink sources. So that if you can decouple from the capture side to storage, like doing direct air capture, you can definitely putting it away. So I think a ton of carbon coming up from the ground, you should put carbon back, or any historic emissions, you have to put it back. And if we work together as a global society, we have plenty of storage options, but it may not be right next to the source, not everywhere.
So we've got a couple of more questions, but before, I just want to ask our remote panelists, in case they don't hear the question or if there's any issue, they should shout and then we'll try to repeat the question or find a way to communicate. So I have a question here on this table and then we go over there.
Anders Weberman. I'm actually with Julio and Elisa that carbon capture and storage is a necessary thing, and I know that this is not easy because, you know, in Germany, for example, all the regional governments have now said we're never going to do it, we're never going to allow it. So I know this is a big thing. What I would hope that we could slowly but surely lay these solar radiation management techniques to rest, because there are a number of issues with it, but I want to highlight one, and that is. With the aerosols that you put in the stratosphere, you have exactly one number that you can control, and that is the amount of aerosols that you put into the stratosphere. One number, and with this one number, you create a pattern of temperature change on the planet. Now, already the first order spatial distribution of this pattern of temperature change is wrong, because you're cooling the places with a high solar influx, which is the tropics, more than you cool the high latitudes. But the global warming pattern is exactly the other way around, as we've learned, right? Polar amplification. There's higher warming in the tropic, in the Arctic than there is in the tropics, which is what you also see in the slides shown by Phil. You see that even if once you have reduced the temperature of the planet back to normal, the average temperature, you still have warming in the high latitudes. And what you didn't see because of the color scaling of Phil's graph is that you have, if the global mean temperature is back to zero temperature increase, but you still have a warming of 1 or 2 degrees in the Arctic, which you saw in his plots, you have to have a temperature reduction in the tropics. So you're really changing your climate. And since we don't have the appropriate models at the moment to know what that actually means, I think you have one number that you control, you have a pattern that you need to control, you don't control it. Very simple. It's not a question, I'm sorry.
It's a comment, all right.
Maybe I can answer that?
Yes, please go ahead.
So one point is, I think if I understood it right, you say that the temperature is, once you have a global, keep the temperatures from warming globally with solar radiation management, but the Arctic is still warming about 2 degrees. But actually, if you look at this plot that I have shown, without solar radiation management, the Arctic is warming way more than if you would apply geoengineering. So I'm not understanding quite that point. The other point is, I think you talked, and it was hard to understand, about stratospheric changes when you inject aerosols there. And what happens is that the particles do reflect sunlight, but they're also in the long wave heat and also interact with the chemistry. So we do get a temperature increase. But it, I'm not sure if I understand how you say the complete climate would change through that.
Yeah, if I can follow up, it's also to say I had a great deal of difficulty understanding the question. So maybe the next time, if the speakers can move closer to the mic, it might help. But it would just also be to say that the changes in the stratosphere are really, well, they are definitely, there is a response, a noticeable response, a discernible response that are due to the aerosols, which is what Simona was talking about. But I think, in fact, much of the residual climate impacts that you see in the presence of, in the stratosphere, that you see in the presence of
we lost you. Can you hear me? No. Phil? I'm afraid we lost Phil, so... No, you could, but if he's not there, then I think maybe we'll come back later, okay? So let's go to the next table and try to be close to a microphone there. Thank you.
All right, I will be as close as I can. Thanks, Dave Titley, and if Phil were there, I would say hi to him, since he and I were both on the National Academy's Committee on Climate Intervention together. My question is, though, for Julio and Elisa, the Academy's climate intervention study basically said the issue with carbon dioxide removal was not so much of risk, it was cost and scale. And it wasn't the CCS of capturing at a source, it was more once it's in the atmosphere, what to do. If you were writing an appendix or an addendum to that report, of that volume on the carbon dioxide removal, what would you say? Would you say that the technology and science have moved significantly from when we wrote those conclusions? And if so, kind of what's that justification, and would the community agree with that, or are we still pretty much, it's a cost and scale issue and we still have a lot of work to do? And again, not at the power plant, but once you get into the atmosphere.
Right, so it is unfortunate the reports like this are written in the absence of hard data from projects. It is the nature of a report without such projects, they got to write something. And so people estimate what the costs are, and they say it's too expensive. The American Physics Society, when their report came out in 2012, I think, or 2010, said it was going to cost $600 a ton. We already know that there are systems that are dramatically cheaper than that. And it's sort of like saying, yeah, well, LEDs are $40 a light bulb, and the costs, of course, have dropped by a factor of 8. We have only just begun to look at these things. It is accurate today to say that the costs are high and scaling up is an issue, and that's sort of like saying the same thing about trains in 1805. It's like we have not really worked on this technology substantively. We have not made investments into ways to reduce cost. We have not sought novel solutions that are different than the conventional industrial solutions that are out there today. And we haven't funded sponsored research on this topic anywhere in the world. So it's accurate, but misleading. I would say that there's caveats out there to say the thermodynamic limits look like this. There are clear pathways to imagine cost reduction. There are ways to get scale through modularity instead of through scale of enterprise. And as a consequence, there are many viable pathways to distributed solutions and to cost reductions that are worth pursuing.
So it's interesting you mentioned those that report. There were two, right? And I was
two volumes of one report.
Two volume,
yes.
And I was actually a reviewer of the carbon removal one. So I didn't get to write the appendix, but I actually had input into it, I guess. So I read that report. I had to read very thoroughly. I think it was a good overview. But as Julio mentioned, this area has not been academically funded in the large scale yet. Most people focus on point source capture, which is about 14 to 15 volume percent of CO2 in the mixture gas. And now we are moving to, if you do natural gas-fired power plant, it's the 5%. Even then, people are saying, do we need to have a new capture material? Now you're going to be against a lower concentration. Now we are going to 400 parts per million. It's more, I guess, we need to revisit. The driving force is less. It means that you might need to have a stronger solvent. So all the people who been working on CO2 capturing from point source, they have tools. They have a lot of background to contribute to developing novel materials which integrate a lot of things, smart materials for air capture, but people haven't really shifted to that direction. So a lot of people like me are looking into, can we make the materials now, anticipating for the future, even negative emission, can we develop the materials can capture CO2 from wide range of concentrations and wide range of conditions, like pressure, temperature, and humidity. So I think with more people on it would be great. Unfortunately, most of these air capture technology being developed and then led to the funding from venture, so it became startup. Once you start doing the startup, less sharing of data, and that really limits the development. So it's a challenge at the same time people working on that concept right now.
Okay, thanks. Yeah, the second law of thermo does tend to get in the way sometimes.
Yes.
Okay, and as I think everybody knows, Phil talked about the recommendations on solar radiation management or albedo modification. That report did recommend increased R&D, research and development, into the carbon dioxide removal component as well. Thanks.
Thank you. Shall we go over to the other table there? We have two questions.
Thanks.
So, please.
Yeah, so this is for all four of you. Part of the premise of this workshop was to think about, given the differential change in the Arctic and the potential for that to disrupt the climate system even further, are there any interventions that can be taken that would avert that? And from what I understood from both of these presentations is that both of these interventions are really global scale. They're not, they don't necessarily have a regional aspect to them, although I thought I heard Philip suggest something about some modeling done to try and for some regional approaches in the Arctic that would maintain sea ice. I'm not sure I heard that correctly. But the question is, are these approaches only applicable generally, globally, or are there any regional applications that we could be thinking about as we think about recommendations for further Arctic science research and development?
So maybe we should start with our remote speakers, Phil or Silmon. Could you start?
Yeah, let me try. Mm-hmm. Can you guys hear me now?
Yes.
I did get disconnected, but I'm back again. And so hopefully I can say, in terms of the solar radiation management, one characteristic that I didn't really talk about was that the impacts are actually quite rapid. It appears that after an introduction of some mechanism for reducing the sunlight reaching the planet, the planet will begin responding over the course of a year or less even. And so it's a relatively rapid response. The ocean, of course, takes a longer time to respond, but many aspects of the intervention would manifest very quickly. The second message to deliver is, yes, people have explored the trying to do local reductions of sunlight, for example, to concentrate the sunlight reductions over the Arctic, and with limited success, I guess. One of the features that we see is that stratospheric aerosols tend to reside for, they have a lifetime of about a year, and they naturally spread by the wind fields so that they cover at least most of a hemisphere, which would limit the possibility of doing a very regional intervention from the stratosphere. It might also be possible to do some kind of an intervention in the troposphere, where the lifetime of the aerosols and the clouds is much shorter. But for the stratospheric aerosols, it's not possible. And another thing to indicate is that we have also learned enough from our models to see that they suggest that if you were to introduce an intervention in the high latitude, let's say in the northern hemisphere high latitudes, that it will have a manifestation of on the circulation over the whole planet by doing things like shifting some of the areas of intense precipitation in the tropics, because it changes the energy balance so that that would, for example, change the rainfall distributions again in the Sahel, or a feature that many of you might know about called the Intertropical Convergence Zone, or ITCZ. It will shift these features. So maybe Simona has some comments too.
Yeah, I do agree with Phil on exactly that. We have done these studies. And one point to add is that besides the precipitation is shifting, if you really only care about the Arctic, it does require a lot. Even if we don't have the problems that the aerosols fall out really quickly, if you put them at a place where they get washed down much faster than in other places in the stratosphere, you also counteract, I mean, you do have the warming. If you don't cool the whole globe, you still have the strong warming and the heat transport from the tropics in both the ocean and the atmosphere. And so you do have to counteract those things as well, which makes it even harder to do that way. The only way to really, I mean, probably the only way is with solar radiation management, at least with particles in the stratosphere, is to do a global intervention. And you may do it differently than mostly presented as an even distribution. You may come up with other ideas that you cool the Arctic more than other places. But those things have not been developed. And that's what I also want to add to Phil's comment on. We can do something really quickly in our model if we inject aerosols. However, in reality, there are no technologies developed at this time. So the question is also in terms of time, how long will it take to develop technologies that you could actually do something in the amount that would be required? And how much time do we have?
If I may, just a couple of quick things. With respect to CO2 capture and storage and stuff, you're really talking about a well-mixed atmosphere and stuff all washes out. But it's worth saying that we already have three other technologies that were not discussed here that are relevant in terms of regional things. David Keith wrote a wonderful paper in 2009 that said, if you build a bunch of wind in the Dakotas, in northern Germany, and in China, you will alter locally the climate. And he showed where he predicted there would be increased rainfall, and some places warming, some places cooling. Hey, we're kind of doing that. There's probably some opportunity to reinvestigate that and see if any of his predictions have come out. Secretary Chu is a big fan of white rooftops and painting roads white and stuff like that. There's ways to do albedo modification that are highly localized. And in another example of one that we sort of are doing in reverse right now is we're putting black carbon into the atmosphere that is enhancing the melt rate of snow in the Arctic. And this is something, these are short-lived aerosols that we can, you know, do pollution control in through things like, you know, compressed natural gas on two-stroke engines and stuff like that. And there's ways to actually get that stuff out of the atmosphere to slow the rate of albedo modification. It is worth noting that those are not geoengineering either, yet are still actually solar reflection management.
Okay. Before going on to the next question, there was a follow-up on this
issue. Yeah, thanks. I'm allowed. Hi, Phil, and it's me again. I'm sorry. I have to explain it again. I mean, you see that if I show my son the observed warming, he'll immediately realize that there's more warming in the Arctic than there is on the west in the rest of the planet. If I then ask him if I would reflect sunlight, he would know that the cooling effect that I get when I reflect the sunlight would be strongest in the tropics and not in the Arctic. This is the first order pattern, right, of both of these. So if you add these together, you get a climate change, and this is actually the climate change that you are observing in your four times CO2 plus geoengineering thing. Now, what happens then is you get the global mean temperature back to zero, if you like, but you change the overall pattern. And for example, what Jennifer showed today, the meandering of the jet stream is something that's strongly associated with the temperature gradient from the pole to the tropics. You would not solve this problem with solar radiation management, and that's why I think, you know, it's time to let's do carbon capture. Let's do that.
Okay. Well, just to respond, I can say that you definitely after solar radiation management, you do. If the GCMs are producing an accurate characterization of the response, you would see a reduced pole to equator temperature gradient and expect that it would have some impact on extremes and teleconnections and things like Jennifer will have shown you. But what I will say, as Simona already said, is that it's a dramatic reduction in the impact compared to the scenario that you would see if you did not produce the intervention. So the issue is, this is not a perfect solution. It's only it's only an approximate solution.
Okay, I think we should go on. I will want to come back to one point that was raised, but we'll do that at the end. But please go ahead. Next question. Please
this one's for Julio.
Yourself.
And it's a tricky one, and I do not have an axe to grind here. It's a genuine question here. But if you, it's striking.
Can you give your name, please?
Oh, Doug Wallace from Dalhousie University in Canada. It's striking, at least in Canada, that the big investments in CCS are from the oil and gas industry, from the oil sands industry, and so on, for probably pretty good reasons, that they have the plant, they have the underground storage capacity, and they have the pipelines in that sector. But the question really is, are they likely to be the most innovative industry? Are other energy-intensive industries, for example, the chemical industry, are they doing as much work? And is there a risk, and I guess this is the heart of the question, is there a risk that these structural issues associated with the oil and gas industry might shut us off from the most promising developments, which might eliminate the problem faster? Is there an industrial policy question here?
Okay, so that's actually two questions, so I'll take them in bits. The first part, is the oil and gas industry creative compared to other heavy industry? The answer is wildly more so. They are wildly more so creative than the other heavy industries. And the reason why is because the margins of things like cement manufacturing and steel manufacturing and petrochemicals are tiny, and the margins for oil and gas are great. I try to explain this to people in the context of desalination. Water from your tap is 50 cents a cubic meter. Water from a desalination plant is $2 per cubic meter. Today, oil is $1,000 a cubic meter. It is incredibly valuable stuff. And these guys make their capital investments expecting low prices, and so they capitalize big. They are also doing very, very sophisticated chemical conversions, material science development, enterprise management, project management. The oil and gas industry is absolutely second to none around this, and they have the most to lose, which is why they're the ones who have actually been sort of the leads on this. Is there a risk that we're missing solutions as a function of the focus from the oil and gas industry? That's a tougher question. I would say that you're always at risk when one industry dominates the research agenda. That's actually the clearest case that I can make for broader federal support. Because basically, if the oil and gas industry is underwriting all the research, then you get the oil and gas solutions. You don't necessarily get the public benefit solutions. Things like air capture are an example of that. It's not their first five things to focus on, but there's demonstrable public benefits around it. It's worth noting that the oil and gas industry has begun to fund direct air capture research, and that's noteworthy too. But in terms of the range of potential pathways, yeah, possibly. I have been personally impressed by the breadth of their investigation, how ecumenical they are about where solutions will come from and how to pursue them. They are very much sort of technology and market agnostic. In contrast, we worked for 30 years to try to get the coal industry to put any money into this, and they put in Zippo. In the past 4 years, they've lost 98% of their market capitalization. So the challenge with the oil and gas industry is a different one. They think they can ride this wave perfectly. They think they have completely gamed when and how they have to act and at what scale. And they, as a consequence, they are at risk for dislocations that they may not be expecting. Given the nature of the global economy and the assets that are tied up in it, that actually puts other components of the global economy at substantive risk as well.
Thank you. Do we have any other questions? So yes, there was one. Thank you. Okay, so two more questions and then we wrap up.
Okay, so let's take the unlikely...
Your name, please.
Peter Schlosser from the Earth Institute. Let's take the unlikely scenario that finances don't play a role. So let's assume, you don't have to worry about how things are financed and from which source it comes. in such a scenario, could you actually get air capture and CCS, so could you get to negative emissions at the scale we are needing, at a time scale that is consistent with COP21 decarbonization scenarios?
I'm happy to answer this. Do you want to go first?
I guess I'm an eternal optimist. Yes, I think so. We know the chemistry. The always when you look at, you need to look at the path, right? So a lot of these life cycle analysis shows that everything is path dependent. That's why we cannot put carbon footprint back of the Coke bottle, right? Because it really depends how you do it. And people been doing a lot of scenario buildup and then analyze them, and it seems to be there are ways, but still, if you're burning coal, get the energy in to do this, it's not going to work. But if you have enough carbon-free energy, we can definitely put it in that way, or the CO2 we capture and put it away. I think we can do it. There's enough storage options, but the, like we discussed, it may not match one-to-one right next to each other, so that we have to kind of work with each other. But overall, are we going to be able to put everything away, even negative emission? Not in 5 years, I don't think so, because it does take, if you look at any chemical industry to scale up, it takes about 20 years. I think we are there's a, something called technology readiness level. So we go 1 through 9, right? And then most of the fundamental research in universities, 1 to 2. And maybe DOE will touch about 3, and then hopefully we'll go to 3 to 6 or so. Industry would not really touch much less than 7, I think. So that there's a big gap. But we are doing, that's why we do pilot scale demonstration and on that, so on. They'll take years. So I think if we do it in large scale, 10, 20 years, we can get to a large deployment of a lot of large scales. But if we are talking about next 5 years, of course, it will be very challenging because it's a capital intensive large scale units.
I could give a long answer on this. I'm going to give a really short one. First of all, the real question is, are we going to take our medicine, which is a different story. We are not limited from the technology end of the business. We are not limited from the scale-up end of the business. We are entirely limited by the climate urgency, and will we embrace it? The other thing that I would say, though, is it is about finance for sure, but it's really about markets. And right now, we don't actually have markets that really reflect the cost of this externality. And if we did, the cost would come down fast and the deployment would go up fast. Absent those kind of drivers, they don't. I have good days and bad days. And on the good days, I think we'll all play nice and figure it out. And on the bad days, I despair. But it's not because of some technical limit or even some political, realpolitik. It is much more about, will we be urgent enough to hit it? And we'll see.
Thank you. And then let's go to the last question, please.
I'm Mujib Latif from Kiel University in Germany. I have actually two questions, if I may. One concerning the solar radiation management. Once CO2 levels in the atmosphere...
I'm sorry, I cannot hear this. Can you come closer to the microphone or something?
Okay, which one? Okay, sorry, I was standing in the back. All right, okay, can you hear me now?
Not appreciably better, no.
Okay.
Okay, can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. So I have one question concerning the solar radiation management. So once you do that, it's really high in the atmosphere, so it makes sense. Probably the land yard to get rid of this issue, if at all. And so we have to continue these measures, for a very long time, okay? You are putting a lot of work and future generation. So are you guys considering any of these issues?
I think you have, if you have listened to my presentation, that was exactly what I addressed. And in particular, the idea that if you have to do I mean, not particular address, but if you do as much as you can in 2040, then you limit your time to 160 years, say. If you wait longer, it would take way longer, and you would limit, you would have a lot, much longer commitment of solar radiation management. And so you're right about that. So the only way to really consider solar radiation management is seeing a way out and really reducing drastically the carbon in the atmosphere, because else, as you say, you have a very long time that you would have to do this and ramp up for even longer time period.
Yes, if I could just follow up, it was to say that Simona just stated it, but in the intervention reports and in the IPCC report as well, we made it clear that we thought it would not make sense to begin a strategy of implementing solar radiation management in the absence of a clear commitment by society to stop emitting CO2 and perhaps even to start drawing down CO2 through negative emissions. It's just, it would be really a bad situation to try to continue to counter increasing CO2 concentrations for a long period of time. So Simona's exploration was making the assumption most of the time, through most of her scenarios, making the assumption that society was committed to a reduction in CO2 emissions and a reduction in CO2 concentrations.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Now, I'm not going to summarize this discussion, but I would like to raise 3 points, and then I would like to ask each panelist to say their last sort of 2 sentences each of how they see the Arctic and the issues that we raised. And of course, just to repeat the beginning, we're talking about what can be done in what time frame, what will be the impacts and the risks, those are, and what scientific research still needs to be done. So that's the background. And the first point that I heard a number of people, but I think we need to be very clear about this, that solar radiation management is not a solution to our problem. Our problem is CO2 and other greenhouse gases. We need to remove that. But yes, solar radiation management under certain circumstances could help us to gain some time, to have a longer transition and so on, but we still have to get rid of the CO2. So it's not a solution, it's a method to make sure that the temperature may stay below a certain level. The second, very important, particularly for the short term, what Julio mentioned, is that markets have to work better. Markets need signals from the politicians, from other places. And once they do get those signals, then things will get going. We have the technologies. We have many of these systems ready, but they are not getting to the stage of massive scale engagement. And the third point I marked here, and I cannot read it. So I think I'll leave. I will leave it at that. So I'd like to ask our panelists just to say 1 or 2 sentences each, and then with that we can wrap up this session. Shall we start with the remote colleagues? Maybe Simona?
I wasn't really, I'm not sure. I haven't thought about it. Go ahead with Phil, maybe.
All right, so my response, you asked about whether what could be done on a short time frame. And my first reaction is there are many uncertainties about component processes that operate for these solar radiation management techniques, which we need to understand better. And these studies could be begun immediately, and they would have payoffs for basic climate science, as well as very important payoffs in understanding the processes that appear to be important for solar radiation management. So I guess that's the first message. And then to say, I although I don't advocate it, it appears that these techniques can operate very rapidly. And it also, Simona indicated that we don't have the technologies today, but it does appear that we could have the technologies for some of these methods within a decade or 2 or 3 decades, so that if one wanted to move very rapidly, there are things that could be done. I personally would prefer that we make sure we at least have made sure that we understand the basic physics well enough to have some confidence in the first impacts, in the initial impacts. That's many more than one sentence or two sentences. I'm sorry.
Okay, I think I can answer now. I probably didn't understand first. I agree with Phil, and just to add what hasn't been done, you would think we understand solar radiation management based on model scenarios, but that's not really true. We haven't really done all these scenarios that are more realistic, and models evolving, the same as if research on solar radiation management evolves, also the models evolving, and we do get better answers with time. So much more research has to still be done, and there's not enough funding for this topic to actually do this.
I agree with that.
So this is how I end usually my seminars to a lot of students, right? Because this problem not going to be solved in our generation. I think it will be something we'll be continue to work on in the future, because we live on a society heavily depending on carbonaceous materials. So first, we need to get rid of the fossil fuels as soon as possible. So renewable kicking in and the cheap price as soon as possible, I'm welcoming that for sure. But it will take time. Until then, a major point source is CO2 capture. We really need to focus on continue to do that so while we are phasing it out, because each country has different needs and different resources that they're going to be using. But if you look at the 100 units of CO2 emission, 93 is big, which is usually power sector and liquid fuels, and there will be a 7%. A lot of people think that 7% drop in the bucket, but that's not true if we have to even considering negative emission. I think eventually in our future generation, we really need to have in renewable energy abundant and cheap enough and efficient enough so that we can manage carbon, putting it away as much as possible, though one even emitted in the past. Once we get there, we can make it. But if we don't study and do R&D and working with government, academia, and industry on all these revenues, we won't make it. So we really need to work with each other.
So I'm between you and drinks. So I'll keep it. This is the 2.5 minute version of the 2.5 hour response to those questions. First of all, we actually just need all this stuff, and we got to stop pretending that we don't. I try to talk to people about this using a metaphor for weight loss. You got to eat less. That's conservation and efficiency. That works. You got to change your diet. You eat more vegetables, eat less carbs. That's renewables and nuclear and other zero emission supplies. You go to the gym and send those calories somewhere else. That's carbon capture and storage. And if you want to do direct air capture, that's hiring a personal trainer. You know, you're putting extra money in to get the weight loss faster. And solar radiation management is basically like gastric bypass surgery. It's what you do in very extreme cases, but I wouldn't want anybody doing that on me without some research first. So how about we do some research first and have some proper solar radiation geoengineering programs out there in the world. With respect to the markets, I come from California, and we have a habit of passing laws before we think about them. In that context, if you ask the legislatures, if you ask the state and assembly members and the Senate members why they're doing what they do, they all uniformly say, we got to reduce carbon dioxide, we're doing it for climate change. When you look at the laws, none of them measure carbon dioxide, none of them measure climate change. Instead, it's rate of amount of renewables on the grid. It is some incentive like 1,300 megawatts of storage. They're not actually managing the thing they care about. Some people want a carbon tax. I think that's lunacy. Some people want cap and trade. I think that's lunacy because politicians won't ever do it. What we can do, though, is the things that people don't care about, which is we set standards. We set standards all the time. We set standards for appliance efficiency. We set standards for car efficiencies. Nobody cares. So we need basically an emission standard. And if we set at 2030, 1,400 pounds per megawatt hour or less, so you can't emit anywhere in the world, the markets would uncork and people would start doing that. And if we said every 5 years we're going to go down 200 pounds per megawatt hour, people would start doing that. Clear market signal, it's big and it's down. And that would be a way to actually get the enterprise rolling, in my humble opinion.
Thank you very much. And I hear lots of positive things for the medium to long term. I'm still worried if I'm the Arctic. But thank you very much, everybody. This was fascinating, and I'm sure we will continue the discussion over the drinks. So, thank you.
So, I'd like to thank everybody who presented and contributed to the discussion today. It was a full day, a great variety of things that we heard.
Teresa, come in here. Teresa, present quickly.